Welcome to Living Word, growing a family that experiences every promise of God. You're listening to another life-changing word from Dr. Tom Anderson. For more information, visit our website at livingwordonline.com.
How many ready for the word today? I don't know whether we can't honk. We're not honking car. I guess we are doing some of that, but amen. Well, I've got a couple of things I want to do this morning, and we're going to try it out and see how it works. This is kind of the title of the song, of the sermon today. And you can sing along a little bit if you like. I'm encouraging you to go exactly the same way. That's an old Elvis song, but it is the title of the sermon today, and it's a pretty simple sermon, I believe, by my whole heart. And I'm trying to figure out how religion missed some of these truths all of these hundreds of years, an attitude of so many things that we had to do when Jesus told us right up front, all we had to do was believe what he said. I said, all we have to do is believe what he said. In fact, salvation's based on believing. Receiving anything good from God is directly connected to believing. And I believe that all things, health, wealth, joy, peace, and highly favored are connected to only believe. And that is an absolute truth, but I have people that ask me a question occasionally, and they'll say, why am I struggling in receiving something good from God? Why is it that I'm struggling in receiving something good from God? Why does it seem like sometimes bad things happen to good people? A lot of those kinds of questions take place. And I want you to realize that God provided something called grace and mercy, even through the Old Testament. He spoke of, surely goodness and mercy or grace shall follow me all the days of my life. David understood that, purely and greatly and easily, even though his life was a mess, he knew that the goodness of God was constantly following him. And he kept his eyes fixed on Christ Jesus. And there's a few things that he was awfully careful to do. If you read through Psalms carefully, you find some interesting things. You see, some of the things that causes you to struggle is if you have any remnant of legalism or law or religious law left in you. See, the enemy uses and applies the law to your life in a whisper, in a word, in a sentence, in a thought, to see if he can get you to apply law to yourself. And what happens when he gets you to believe that and apply law to yourself, you enter condemnation. And in condemnation, you're in a position that you can't receive anything from God because you know that you're not worthy. Yet the Bible tells me that you're worthy 27:4:27. I mean, you're worthy all of the time because Jesus paid for past, present, and future so that you could live by this grace of God no matter what was going on, so that you could constantly be in a position to receive. But if you place yourself back under the law, you begin to struggle. It's just fascinating how the enemy has used the law through the ages to keep us from receiving all the good things that God has for us. Religious law. I remember all of the crazy, crazy situations when we were first born again and in a particular denomination that everything, I swear, everything was against the law to do except eat. Nobody has ever been there, but, and they did eat. Lord Jesus, did they eat? But when it came down to regulations, I remember my wife could only wear culottes. You had to wear a dress, you couldn't wear pants. So when we finally bailed out of that church, actually we got thrown out of that church, because she was filled with the Holy Spirit, so they wanted us to deny the Holy Spirit. I said, we're not going to do that because it's in the Bible, and so we were asked to leave. The first thing I did was go down to Bell Scott's and buy her a pair of slacks and take her to a movie. Nobody's laughing out there, or maybe you are. But because it is critical to get to a place where we live by the goodness and the grace of God. See, when you enter into judgment of someone else, you have applied law to their life, and that puts you in a position of it. If you get offended with someone, you have applied the law to somebody's life. When you enter unforgiveness, you've applied law to the situation and circumstance because they haven't measured up to what you think is the particular standard. That's why this attitude at Living Word Bible Church is be you. We love you just like you are. If God loves you just like you are, my gosh, I guess we ought to. And I would want you to love me just like I am. And I am not perfect. I'm pretty close, but not perfect. And so we have to get to a position and a place where we don't use those, but we apply this thing called grace to every person that we meet. When you apply grace, you're actually applying the love of God. I said, when you apply grace to their situation, this is why the Bible's so clear that we're to bless our enemies and bless those that accuse us and bless those. We don't have to fight with them. We don't have to argue with them. The accusers only have the problem of their own accusations, so you don't have to go there. You don't have to defend yourself in the circumstance. You know who you are, and the people that love you know who you are, and you don't have to worry about all of those. Come on, somebody, you ought to understand. Glory to God. We need to make sure that we stay out of judgment, offense, and unforgiveness. Stay out of it. Lend grace to every person that you come into contact with. Lend grace and mercy because they're where they're at. I love it when Maureen does that in the car. I put people sometimes under the law that cut me off. Nobody else does that, but I get a little upset because you're threatening my family by your stupidity. And so, but that's really, she says, well, they might be going to the hospital, and maybe they're sick and dying, and maybe they just, you know, just got a divorce. And she's got all kinds of grace and mercy for these people. I'm growing in it. When I'm preaching, you know, sometimes I'm actually preaching to myself. I don't know whether you knew that or not out there, but it is nonetheless true. And I got to thinking about this just a little bit. Go to John chapter 6, verse 28 and 29. Let's take a look at this, if you have it up there. The disciples came to Jesus and they said, "What are the works of God?" And isn't it interesting? Here's this scripture that's right boldly in the book of John, and somehow religion seems to have skipped it. Because Jesus explains perfectly the works of God is to believe in him who he sent. Hello? It doesn't have any other, there's no other conclusions, there's not another sentence that explains it. It's just believe, only believe. That's all he asked us to do, was to believe his word. If he said it, by his stripes you're healed, then it's true. It is the only truth known to man, is what we have written in this book. His word is true, and he stands by it. And the only hindrance we have is things and decisions that we may make. He just asked us to believe. In fact, Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 through 27 talks very clearly about how important it is that out of the abundance of the heart come the issues or the behavior of life. That's why if any of offense or unforgiveness or judgments living in your heart, it's going to produce behavior that operates in law rather than operates in the grace and the mercy of God. That's the reason it says out of, because all of your behavior, all of your actions in life, even how your heart beats, is run by your heart. Out of the content of the heart, how critical and important it must be. Jesus is the one that said we have to stay in a position of just believing. Because when we get into the works and trying to be good enough and try to excel in something, I thought it's interesting, if you have your Bibles again, turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 17. Verse 8 and 9, it's an interesting story. The first thing you'd have to ask yourself is this simple question. Were there no poor widows in Israel? Well, of course there were. Thousands and thousands. But isn't it fascinating that he sent Elijah to a widow in Sidon? Not in Israel. Now, why would he send her send the prophet to an unbelieving location to save her life and her son, to bring salvation, if you will, because in Israel, the widow would not have believed because they lived by the law. And he had to send them to someone that had to just believe. Hello? Someone that just did what the prophet said and believed God, and miracles took place in her life. There's another example of that with Elisha. When there were lepers all over, there was leper colonies in Israel. It isn't it interesting that Elisha is sent to a leper Naaman in Syria, of all places? Were there no lepers that could be healed? And of course. But when we look at this, why did he send again to a heathen nation? To prove the power of the word of God, he said, go into the river and dip seven times. And even he resisted it, but finally believed. And on the seventh time was completely healed and whole. Because he didn't have any law to deal with, he could receive the full grace of the living God. If you want to receive any good thing from God, just turn away from all of the legalism and law and religion and purely believe the Father and what he said. That's why the song, "Only Believe." He'll lift your burdens. He'll set you free. He'll change your tomorrows. He'll make tomorrow better. He'll make, oh, come on, somebody ought to get a hold of this today. You have to just believe what he said. Boy, what a time we've got now sitting at home. I'm kind of fascinated by the fact that they tell us to stay in the house. And then something that I've known for probably 45 years, one of the reasons that I open all of our shades, make sure we open the whole house up every day, is because they discovered something. Scientists apparently must have just discovered this, because I just heard it on TV yesterday, that the virus dies in sunlight. Oh my gosh. Can you imagine that? But then they told you to stay in the house. Now that's absolutely stupid. Or they just didn't know, or there's something weird going on. But I believe Arizona's about to open up. I believe that America's about to open up. The economy is coming back, and everything that's ever been lost is going to be returned to you. Sevenfold is what my Bible says. That's what my God says. So don't you believe anything else, because he said it. It's going to happen, and you're going to be blessed and on the other side of this. And we'll finally get rid of this. I don't even know what they do in banks when everybody's got a mask on. You can't identify the burglar. Not going well. I can't tell if they're laughing or not, so I've got to quit. Hi, I hope you've enjoyed my program today. I know we're trying to take the Word of God and really bring understanding to your heart, that it has the power, the Word of God has the power to change your life. And so I just ask that you continue to subscribe, tune in, share with somebody, but continue to grow in Christ and the Word of God. It's the most powerful thing in the universe. It can change everything in your life. I want to make sure that people out there that are listening have had an opportunity to receive Christ. You may know about Christ, you may believe the Bible, but you've never received Jesus as Lord and Savior. I prayed that prayer when I was 27 years old, changed and revolutionized my entire life. I just encourage you to pray this prayer with me. Just speak it aloud today, and it will change your whole life. Just try it and watch and see. God is faithful to do what he said. So I just ask you to repeat after me. Dear Father God, I ask you to forgive me of all my sin, and I invite Christ Jesus to be my Lord and my Savior. I receive you now, Jesus, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm telling you, your life will be revolutionized. Call us and let us know if you've tuned in. Continue to watch the program and grow in the Word of God. It's the best life there is on this earth. God bless you.